Greetings, Guardians. My name is Bife here. Today we're going to be doing something a little different, and we're going to be talking about the various family members of Clovis Bray, as well as the Clovis Bray Corporation, which was responsible for the creation of the War Mines, hence why it's relevant. Also, Anna Bray. You know, obvious connection, family and all that. Their importance to the story of Warmind is pretty paramount, considering that the corporation didn't just create the AIs, but also due to the fact that there may indeed be a living Bray family member today. Spoiler alert, yes indeed there is. So with Anna Bray appearing on the front cover, it's kind of important that we understand the baggage that this family holds and that we also acknowledge what they did for the system. All the good and all of the questionable actions. In order to do so, I actually want to take us all the way back to the Golden Age to start, and we're going to start with the memoirs of Clovis Bray. But not THE Clovis Bray. Clovis the Elder named his son Clovis Bray II, almost like one of the old dynastic kings, because why wouldn't you, I guess? You own a mega corporation, you might as well keep it in the family. It's Clovis Bray II's memoirs that we'll be reading, and in particular, this certain part stands out above the rest. My father hated maps. "And do you know why I hate maps?" he asked me. I didn't answer, not immediately. With father, every question was vast, particularly those that looked simple. And simple questions deserved as much insight and wisdom as could be brought to bear. With that in mind, I said nothing. Why would my father hate maps? "I don't know why you hate maps," I admitted. With father, ignorance was never the worst crime. What was awful was pretending to have insight and wisdom where neither existed. "Maps end," he said. I nodded, just a little. Maps insist on having borders and edges or the table falls away, which isn't the way the universe works. It doesn't, no, I agreed. Then he asked me, "So how does the universe work?" I pretended to take my time, considering various smart answers, but I ended up using my first impulse. "Effortlessly," I said. He laughed, which wasn't uncommon for my father, but it was heartening to hear just then. "What else can you tell me?" he asked. "The universe is infinite and probably in multiple ways," I said. Then I listed a few examples, the census of stars, the many worlds principle in quantum mechanics, and the endless nature of tiny realms hiding inside every grain of Martian sand. Father nodded. The smile died. Then he said something ominous, although I didn't appreciate it at the time. "The universe is someone's map," he said. "Is it?" I muttered. "Yes, oh yes. And what we're doing here, we're reaching beyond the boundaries, out into the unknown. And we pull back new colors to put on this map that can never, ever let itself be finished." All of this makes me think of Clovis Bray as less of a businessman and more of a visionary. Think back to the images of Sir Peter Weyland from the Alien universe, and suddenly the comparison becomes particularly apt. I say this not simply to compare the fact that the two men undoubtedly propelled humanity forward in their respective universes, but because of the fact that they were also willing to be lax in terms of ethical oversight. This is best displayed in the studies conducted by Willa Bray, yet another Bray family member, who was responsible for overseeing the creation of SIVA. The nanites were much like any of the other inventions of Clovis Bray. They are generally applicable to many things, and changed humanity, in many ways, for the better, but also provided a terrifying tool if used incorrectly or with malicious intent. The clear benefits of SIVA, well, colonialism. Colonies could be created within seconds, using SIVA to create anything from habitats to environmental suits. Complex structures could be formed almost instantly, but we also saw the benefits of SIVA when used as an offensive weapon against the Iron Lords when Rasputin used it. In spite of the clear dangers of SIVA, the Clovis Bray Corporation saw fit to test its new development on various human subjects, from willing participants to those obligated to join the program due to monetary troubles. The results of these tests were recorded by the doctor on hand at the time, a certain Dr. Shirazi. Her records were unearthed during the Transmission Crisis, an event prior to Rise of Iron, where uncontrolled Siva was found in a Clovis Bray facility on Mars and started to circulate amongst the Guardians of the Last City, granting various benefits but also presenting a huge potential problem. If the Siva that had infected the Guardians suddenly caused adverse effects, the city would be rendered potentially helpless. Their entire stock of immortal fighters rendered helpless in an instant. There was some precedent for this terrifying result, considering that the subjects in Shirazi's tests experienced a variety of detrimental side effects, as well as certain beneficial or near-miraculous phenomena. One of them was initially comatosed, before literally breaking out into song and dance uncontrollably. Another became temporarily mute, and then began to lose weight and hair. Another still reported invisible insects floating around her head, which later materialized into visible blue nanites, which made her float about 2 inches off the ground. Another experienced increased aggression, as well as increased strength, breaking several pieces of equipment in the process. The tests on these subjects were all run in parallel as well, and this was primarily done to save time and money, but this had the added side effect that if any issues arose, as they did, the subjects were not isolated into different test groups, which meant that everyone was simultaneously at risk. The side effects would eventually subside, but the intent to use Siva on human subjects gives a clear example of the lengths which Clovis Bray was willing to go to in order to accomplish its aims as a corporation, scruples or not. Willa Bray might have overseen Siva and its creation, but it wasn't her only project. Much as I said, Clovis Bray's inventions had many applications, and she was responsible for the creation of a technology that we all use to this day, namely, engrams. By looking into the unique structure of relic iron crystals, she discovered what would be called Destiny's fourth state of matter. This plays somewhat with real science, considering that the fourth state of matter is actually plasma, but a new state of matter nonetheless, where data is free from matter. A great deal of work that Clovis Bray made was done within the city of Freehold, a grand metropolis set on Mars. This is where Willa Bray's laboratory was located, and was also where we see the memoirs of Clovis Bray II playing out. The city was built around the need for scientific advancements and aimed to give scientists the freedom they needed to experiment. The technological marvels that Clovis Bray might have borne witness to here are untold and unfathomable, but Alton Bray put words to this achievement, describing the city as a place where men went to challenge the gods. The final two family members of Clovis Bray are a little bit of an anomaly, and considering that one of them was a guardian, there are a myriad of questions that arise. Their names are Elsie and Anna. Elsie is known for a single reference, namely, this ship, the Aeon Trespass, a ship that was born from her mind 3 years prior to her disappearance. Whether this was a ship of Golden Age design or one found later after the collapse is not entirely clear. Many of the ships we use are recovered Golden Age designs, but there are also quite a few that are newly made from the city's foundries. And so, it's not totally clear here. But what I will say is that it matters infinitely less than all of the accomplishments of her sister, or maybe descendant? Ancestor? Anna Bray is a far more storied character. Anna Bray is particularly peculiar because she is a guardian. She's a gunslinger hunter with a fierce reputation and at least a partial association with the FWC, who noted her disappearance and stated that she was lost to us since the Battle of the Twilight Gap had ended. Speaking of which, that battle is partly famous because of her incredible command of the light. There are areas of light on the barricades of the Twilight Gap that still linger because of the strength of her power. She also is of significance because of the sigil of her wolf, which appears on the front cover of the Warmind expansion, on her left shoulder, here. There are many questions about Anna Bray that were left unanswered until recently, but amongst the most pressing of these was how she remembered that she was indeed a member of the Bray family. You see, Guardians don't retain any memories of who they were before. When you die, you lose your memory of your past life. And with all of that said and done, the name of the entire Bray family might well have been lost and wiped out entirely to the collapse. Now, it's not impossible that the Brays did survive, after all, there's a chance that Elsie designed that ship after the collapse. But you see, Guardians are an interesting question, particularly when someone picks up a family name. When Guardians have been chosen by ghosts, the memories of their past life being gone means that it's incredibly hard for someone to rediscover who they were. But in Anna's case, it appears that she was lucky. When she was awoken by her ghost, she discovered a clue, a vital clue in fact, her name badge. She was Anastasia Bray, a member of a famous family, one that had driven the whole of human civilization forward, and she had found more than simply this. According to the comic, her eyes and the adjustments that she found were also a small bit of inheritance from Clovis Bray, although maybe more liberally acquired than her name badge, which would have been on her corpse. This rests a long-standing debate, with the expansion being revealed, of whether Anna Bray had simply adopted the name as a sort of Hunter-esque way of stealing a bit of fame, or whether she was indeed a member of the Bray family before. This mirrors, in a way, the path of another hunter known as Shinobu, who did also find proof of her identity on her corpse when she was chosen by her ghost. And with her death being several hundred years ago, presumably, she had a different story to that of Shinobu. But Anna is indeed who she says she is, and even with her being chosen as a guardian, we then have to take this into account. She does indeed know who she was. She is a very privileged guardian as a result. After the Battle of the Twilight Gap, Anna Bray's appearance appears to not simply be something of chance, but instead was, in fact, her own choice. She decided to go back and attempt to rediscover the past. Supposedly, this is a rule, although I must admit I've never seen any notion of it written before. Guardians are supposedly not meant to discover anything about their past. They are not supposed to pursue it. And so, Anna Bray went off the grid, allowing herself to be forgotten, allowing her legend to persist because, of course, how could she not? It's out of her hands at that point. But she went back and began to search for her legacy, to find out more about herself and her family, and to discover why. Why the collapse happened, why the war mines abandoned everyone, and trying to understand if Rasputin might be our salvation. We also got a look at how she made progress with a great deal of her research into Clovis Bray. Being out in the field and without a concentrated level of resources to work with, she did indeed need help. And in the newly updated narrative preview of Destiny 2 Warmind, we now see that she was indeed getting help from inside the city, and it would be revealed that this assistance would come from a certain Camryn. The relevant section of the narrative preview reads as follows. Anna, told you I remembered an article from the Mars research we were doing at Owl's Sector. This could be what you're looking for, if you can dig it out. Reinhardt goes on for a few hundred pages from here. I'll send the whole thing to Jinju if you're interested, but his conclusions are all wrong, because he never mentions the one thing that could have done this. There's something in Hellas Basin, and you're going to be the one to find it. Camryn. Getting help from inside of Owl Sector is no small feat. They're a secretive group that's only ever activated in times of great calamity. So secretive, in fact, that they are compared in some cases, or at very least have communicative links, to Ikora's network of Hidden, and have communicated directly with the Vanguard in times such as the Transmission Crisis when we first heard of them. The article that Camryn is referencing is in fact pointing towards one of the central plot points of the expansion. Namely, the melting of the ice caps around the Hellas Basin, where the Warmind expansion will take place. However, what's more telling than this are the events as recorded in the new Warmind comic. We'll be covering this in the next video, but for the moment, you can read it all for yourself in the link in the description, and you can see how Camryn and Anna's story unfolds. And with that, we've covered the majority of what we need to know about the family of Clovis Bray. This is a famous family, one that might well have had more of an impact on the world of Destiny than any other. One that is directly related to Rasputin and the War Mines, one that had its banner flown at Twilight Gap, one that led the way in Freehold and propelled humanity to the stars. They were architects, they were engineers, they were pioneers, and yes, one of them was a Guardian. They are the ones responsible for arming the great machines that defended humanity. They are the ones responsible for creating these weapons of war. Their history is inescapable. Their effects on the system are intertwined with almost everything we do, and their relevance to the War Mind is paramount. But now that we understand more of their history, we can push forward into the unknown. But with this, we might find something truly remarkable. Because after all, you have to remember, Anastasia Bray is searching for the War Mind as a savior of humanity. Imagine if she succeeds. Imagine if we at very least get clarity. We might well be on the verge of uncovering the secrets of what happened during the collapse, and there are only a few other records that speak of this time, and they are filled with doom and darkness. But that's all from me for now. If you enjoyed this video, you can leave a like, and if you want to ask me more questions or if you have any commentary for yourself, the comment section is open down below. Of course, because YouTube is dumb, you can hit the subscribe button, but if you really always want to keep up to date, please hit the bell. I hate asking every time, I know that every content creator does, but as always, if you do want to stay in tune, that is the way to do it. More videos coming, I'm hoping to keep this daily schedule up. Thank you so much for all the support, guys, it's really been quite fantastic. I'm so happy to see every single one of you is enjoying the videos, and wow, am I looking forward to giving you guys some more to read about. But anyway, comic tomorrow, and then after that we're going to talk about a few other things here and there to do with my concerns about the expansion, and also we're going to be going over Legends of Destiny, Rasputin. So, all of that, some exciting content I've got planned for you in the next few days. Thank you so much for everybody who has turned up and watched. Remember that your viewership is always quite enough for me. And in the meantime, my name has been, my name is Bife. Hrodasia Ad Astra. I'll see you, Starside.